I am Dr. Mangesh Divaskar, and I would be talking to you on normal weight obesity. Before I do that, I would like to express my gratitudes, my thanks to entire SRN MCON team, especially Dr. Umesh Khanna and Dr. Akash Singhada, and all those who were involved in this beautiful conference. I would like to especially appreciate Dr. Umesh Khanna for giving me this special topic to talk. So a big fat thank you to you, sir. Now, friends, we all know that if we are witnessing an epidemiological transmission from the infectious disease to the chronic degenerative man-made diseases as a primary cause of mortality. And as you can see on the slide, that there is a dramatic shift in the death rate from younger to older, but then from communicable to non-communicable diseases. So we may be living a little longer than what we used to be before, but then very unhealthily. And as far as the obesity incidence is concerned, we can clearly see that India has got nearly 13% of obesity, where they have used body mass index to be greater than 30. And this is a study which was done by Dr. R.M. Anjana for the ICMR. And they found out that in the ICMR in-depth study, the incidence of generalized abdominal and combined obesity in India was nearly in a range of 56 to 70%. But then my question is always that are all obese people are sick, or are all normal weights are normal? The clear answer is absolutely no. Why? Because the assessment metrics that we use to assess obesity, like BMI, body weight, or waist circumference, or body fat percentage, are absolutely non-standardized, and they do have some gray areas. Like BMI has got limitations that it does not take the percentage of the body fat. Also, it does not consider the organ fat deposition or the variations with gender, age, ethnicity, everything. Neither it considers the metabolic, the environmental, or the genetic parameters. And unfortunately, it was never created to be a measurement of health status. And if you really look at the J-shaped relationship, you know, it also has got a problem, because if you can see here that if you pass in a horizontal line, you can clearly see that the mortality is almost similar at the BMI of 18 to 30, which is not really a very well, I would say, studied parameter. Now, the waist-hip ratio is not always reproducible, and especially it is not a useful tool when the BMI is above 35. Coming to body fat percentages, it is not well validated. Along with that, it is very expensive, and not all methods which are usually used to estimate the body fat are practical or sometimes even accurate. So my suggestion is to consider obesity assessment. There are different factors we need to consider when you assess the obesity, right from age, ethnicity, gender, to associated cardiovascular risk factors. And of course, you need to consider genetics as well, and then the other possibly comorbid conditions like insulin resistance or fitness marker or waist circumference. So if you really want to classify obesity, it can be classified into four phenotypes overall. Normal weight centrally obese, normal weight metabolically obese, metabolically healthy obese, and metabolically unhealthy obese. We are going to be talking about normal weight metabolic obese. This is the classic Indian phenotype, as we know, or the terminology of thin fat Indian or toffee Indian, you know, thin from outside, fat from inside, or mound Indian, that is metabolically obese normal weight Indian. Those are characterized by very high insulin resistance, high inflammatory markers, low levels of adiponectin, a classical Indian dyslipidemia triad, and of course, the very high susceptibility to develop the cardiovascular diseases. And the classic example is this YY paradox, where you can see Professor Dr. Chittaranjan Yagnik on your right and Professor John Yudkin at your left. Dr. Yagnik from Pune, PJMC Pune, and Dr. Yudkin from Oxford. And then when they did their DEXA scan, look at the fat percentages at the same BMI. Both had an identical BMI, but the DEXA scan revealed BMI of 9% with Dr. John Yudkin, and in Dr. Yagnik, look at the fat percent. And this paper was an instant international super hit. In fact, this has become one of the, I would say, presentation highlight in many of the conferences. So if you really look at the Toffee or a Mon people, it's not just the fat mass disease, but also it is a sick fat disease, or what we also call as adiposopathy, because it comprises of elevated blood glucose levels. There is an endocrine dysfunction which has happened. The blood pressure goes up, dyslipidemia, and other metabolic parameters are there. So if at all we need to actually define obesity in the correct terms, it is the chronic relapsing multifactorial neurobehavioral disease, wherein there is an increase in the body fat, but you know, it may not be related to the weight, and adipose tissue dysfunction and the abnormal fat mass physical forces resulting into adverse metabolic, biochemical, and psychosocial health consequences. And obesity becomes a disease where there is an excessive body mass, fat mass related to the weight, and it is also influenced by the epigenetic factors or exposome, developmental factors, neuroendocrine dysfunction, medications, nutritional status, unfavorable environmental factors. So remember that the multiple pathogenic adipocytes and the multiple adipose tissue endocrine and immune dysfunction, what we called as sick fat disease, is the situation where you can call the obesity as disease. And this is what I was talking about as a sick fat milieu, where you can see that there is a presence of what we know as a metabolic syndrome. Now, we know that adipose tissue is a very active endocrine organ, and it pours out the hormones, the various hormones, which are also called as adipokines. There are over 600 bioactive adipokines which are there, and they have a role in the regulation of appetite, satiety, fat distribution, inflammation, and endothelial function. And they are involved in the crosstalk between the adipose tissue, between the brain, liver, skeletal muscles during the metabolism. And also, they act on the macrophages. Remember that adipose tissues are full of macrophages. So any dysregulation happening there induces what we call it as meta-inflammation. And this is usually induced by the nutritional disequilibrium. And there is a presence of dysregulated low-grade dysfunction of the chemokines and cytokines that actually change the immune cell responses. And what happens is that there is an outrageous outpouring of what we know as inflammasomes, which lead to the disruptive crosstalk between the organs of metabolism. And you can clearly see that there is a disruption happening. So adipose tissue in a non-inflammatory state or non-inflamed state or a normal state will have macrophages around 10 to 15% of the immune cells which are present. And the environment is classically called as M2 environment, that is called as an anti-inflammatory environment, where in a non-inflammatory state, there is the high level of cytokine interleukin-10 and interleukin-1RA. But then whenever there is a hypertrophied adipose tissue or a dysfunctional adipose tissue, the macrocyte and the macrophage population goes higher to 40 to 50%. And this M2 state switches itself to what we call it as M1 stage or a pro-inflammatory stage, causing the secretion of the inflammatory cytokines like TNF-alpha and interleukin-6. So wherever there is an altered immune response, there is high outpouring of macrophages, neutrophils, CD8, that is cytotoxic T cells, the plasma cells, the mast cells, they get active, especially in the visceral adipose tissue. And there is a reduction in the T helper cells and the regulatory T cells and the eosinophils in the adipose tissues. So this is how the lean adipose tissue will look in a balanced energy homeostasis, where you can clearly see that in an anti-inflammatory atmosphere, there are the inhibitory natural killer cells which are high, the eosinophils are high, the regulatory T cells are high, and T helper 2 cells are high. Whereas you can see that here neutrophils are low, CD8 counts are low in a pro-inflammatory phase, and the T helper 1 cells are low. But the moment there is an adipose tissue dysfunction or inflammation occurring or a pro-inflammatory state, you can clearly see that all these regulators like inhibitory natural killer cells, eosinophils, regulatory T cells, TH2 cells, they will all go down and the counter cells will increase. And that leads to what we call it as a very, very angry fat disease, where there is an outrageous outpouring of all these inflammasomes or the cytokines and chemokines outside. See, look at this, where the leptin levels, they go up, the aromatase level, they go up, the interleukin-6, TNF-alpha, and the MCP-1, the levels they go up, and the adiponectin levels, which are protective, will go down, and that leads to the impact on the various organs, and the extravaganza of beta inflammation continue in liver, causing high insulin resistance, increased glycogenolysis. In the skeletal muscles, it will lead to altered phosphorylation of the receptors, and therefore there is a poor availability of the glucose transferase 4, which is responsible for the glucose metabolism. Then there will be a beta cell strain because of the effect on the islet cell Langerhans and lipotoxicity, which is happening. And there will be an alpha cell hyperplasia, causing the rise in the glucagon levels and reduction in the GLP-1 synthesis. And at brain, there will be a neuroappetite dysregulation, and there is a dysregulation of satiety and hunger axis. And meta-inflammation is usually caused by high amount of mitochondrial reactive oxygen species and leading to endoplasmic reticular stress. And remember that there is a non-enzymatic glycosylation of the proteins, causing the increase in the ER stress. And there is a glucose auto-oxidation happening. There is increased free fatty acid release, and a glucose oxidation also leads to increase in the beta oxidation, causing the reduction in the adiponectin. And the vicious cycle continues, that wherever there is an endoplasmic reticular stress, there will be the release of inflammatory chemokines like Janus K and the NFK kappa beta, that will stimulate the macrophage infiltration in the adipose tissue, and then that calls for the increase in the cytokine levels. The inflammatory cytokines levels will go up, which will worsen the insulin resistance. Now, these inflammatory cytokines will also increase the meta-inflammation and will also cause rise in the leptin levels and will cause reduction in the adiponectin level. And this will in turn increase the adiposity, will increase the oxygen stress, oxidative stress, and will further worsen the ER stress. So the vicious cycle between the inflammation, immune response, and metabolic upset continues, and the interplay goes on. I would just quickly touch upon the subcutaneous adipose tissue and the visceral adipose tissue. Lot of people, they blame visceral adipose tissue more, and they feel that the subcutaneous adipose tissue can be protected. No, it's not that way. Remember that both the types of adipose tissues, subcutaneous as well as, or the peripheral as well as the visceral adipose tissues, they work for providing the storage of energy, physical padding, and thermal insulation. But more importantly, you need to understand that if adipocyte proliferation and differentiation were sufficient just to mitigate or stop the adiposopathic adipocyte hypertrophy, that means that there is a worsening of the endocrinopathy and inflammation and lipotoxic energy overflow to the other depots. So suppose the subcutaneous fat is able to shift the whole thing to visceral fat, probably the obesity will never occur, or the metabolic disease will never occur. And that is the reason why you need to remember that both SAT as well as VAT are potentially protective as well as pathogenic. SAT and VAT, they do serve as a mass, and the functions are interdependent. So there is also a crosstalk which is happening between a SAT and a VAT. And they both express the endocrinopathies and the immunopathies related to the metabolic disease. And especially in the normal weight, metabolically obese individuals, there is increase in both visceral adipose tissue as well as the subcutaneous adipose tissue. So how do you differentiate between a metabolically healthy obese and an unhealthy obese? There are four conventional measures. Measure the blood pressure, look at the HDL cholesterol, find out the triglycerides, and also find out the fasting glucose level. And also some people have few other criteria added. But remember that to say somebody as metabolically unhealthy, at least presence of two or more risk factors are necessary, like blood pressure should be higher than 130 over 85, triglyceride levels to be above 150. The HDL levels are usually less than 40 in males and less than 50 in females. And of course, the fasting blood glucose is usually above 100, and the waist circumference is usually above 102 in males and more than 88 in females. If they are not there, then they are metabolically normal obese. And that is the reason why a clear risk stratification can be also done by the estimation of CRP, adiponectin, and probably the presence of fatty liver or NAFLD. And this is the difference. Look at the metabolically healthy obese. Even though they are obese, the BMI is 30, but they have got high insulin sensitivity, favorable lipid profile, and lack of hypertension. Whenever there is a metabolically obese normal weight, you can clearly see that there is a high waist circumference, HbA1c goes up, the triglycerides goes up, the CRP levels goes up, the lipid accumulating products, they go up. There is a low HDL, there is a low adiponectin. And almost same is seen even in the normal weight individuals, those who are metabolically deranged. And these are the people, those who are called classically as puffy individuals. And genetics plays an important role in this. Remember that metabolically unhealthy obese individuals, they seem to have a difference in the distribution of the adiposity in comparison to metabolically healthy obese. And specific gene differences, they do exist. And the differences in the gene regulation, especially in the white adipose tissue, is a primary culprit. And both the difference between the amino acids and the branch chain amino acid catabolism, especially happening into the saturated situations in the subcutaneous tissue, will also cause a problem. A very interesting finding quickly I'll share, that whenever there is a weight gain in a normal body weight metabolically upset or the metabolically unhealthy individual, the risk of developing a cardiovascular or the metabolic risk is much higher than the other other persons. So friends, chronic meta-inflammation is a situation which can impact not only the current living, but also can impact the genetic and the phenotypic environments. So all these exposomes, like the psychological stress, you know, then the family history, medication, inflammation, unhealthy diet, the pregnancy and diabetes, smoking, all these things, disturbed sleep, will actually add on to get engraved in your genes, and sometimes your future generations can suffer. So finally, management of TOFI, the best way is to have a good therapeutic lifestyle change. Along with that, you are looking for tobacco cessation and target specific pharmacotherapy. I'll not go into the details about this because of the want of time, but remember that the basic mantra to treat this TOFI or metabolically obese normal weight people is prevention. And these prevention policies have to be more proactive than reactive. So to summarize, you need to understand the differences between the metabolically obese and unhealthy individuals, metabolically obese but normal, metabolically normal but overweight individuals. You need to also understand that the outcomes are much worse in normal weight metabolically obese individuals in comparison to metabolically healthy obese people. So understand the differences and act accordingly. And the best way to treat is prevention. I'll end up with the saying that one quarter of what you eat keeps your life. The other three quarters keeps your doctor alive. This was the heliographic writing found in the ancient Egyptian code. Thank you very much.